a marine scientist, ocean explorer, conservation policy specialist, and submarine pilot. David E. Guggenheim, Ph.D., is the founder and president of Ocean Doctor, a nonprofit organization committed to advancing the conservation of the world's oceans. He also teaches ocean stewardship and sustainability at Johns Hopkins University, is an award-winning photographer, and he was inducted into the Explorers Club as a national fellow. Though the last 60 years have witnessed the worst decline in ocean health in human history, his book, The Remarkable Reefs of Cuba, offers a surprisingly optimistic vision for marine recovery by exploring the resilience of Cuba's coral reefs. Please welcome David Guggenheim.
Thanks so much, Andy. Thank you for being here, and so many faces from the past, and it's just wonderful to catch up with everybody. I have to warn you in advance, I'm going to depress the hell out of you for a little bit of this, but I promise by the end you will be happy and uplifted. I'm excited. My students turned out for the book launch today, but if you've read it, you know it's more than just Cuba that this book is about. And of course, we have to ask the question, why Cuba? So let me start with a little bit of the explanation. See why I've been going there for more than 20 years? Now, neighbors don't always get along. And that's the case with the US and Cuba. But you know, if something happens in the neighborhood, we gotta rally together and work things out. And in fact, we are connected. I mean, politically, it looks a lot different than if you put a mask on and look underwater, and you see there are underwater corridors, these fish, this grouper. Actually, Cuban fish grow up to be American fish. It's really true. The larvae can make the journey across and be viable. So, you know, there's a good connection. This turtle carries no passport. They regularly travel across international borders. Cuban sea turtles or that nest in Cuban beaches hang out in the United States. So our partner over much of this time, over these 20 plus years, has been the University of Havana and their luxurious Center for Marine Research. This is their good boat. Actually, it just sank. Their other boat sank 20 years ago. This is a ferro-cement hull. It's made out of concrete. And not so good for the kind of research that we wanted to do with Cuba and the Gulf of Mexico. And it was clear we were going to need a bigger boat. So there aren't that many boats in Cuba. Cubans on boats, not a good thing in the Cuban government's mind. And the one boat that we really wanted to use was owned by Comandante de la Revolucion, Guillermo García Frías. He fought with Fidel in the Sierra Maestre. He's a very friendly looking chap. And I ended up at a meeting with him and a number of people before my Spanish was very good. We had an interpreter sitting behind me, but if you've watched Seinfeld, he was a low talker. You couldn't hear him at all. So I had to switch to Spanish, and whatever I said, he said, "Momento, ¿cómo es posible un gringo de Washington, D.C. está aquí en mi oficina hablando español perfectamente?" So I think you got the gist of that. So we became unlikely colleagues. We got the boat, and we did 10 years of expeditions. And Cuba's northwestern coast, which had never been explored, about 22 scientific papers came out of this, the first maps of the Gulf of Mexico. And an unexpected side benefit of this was the fact that these graduate students were actually out on a boat instead of walking a mile with a tank on their back to dive off of Havana, which is what they have been doing. You know, if you're a marine biologist, it's kind of important, or training to be, to get on the water. So the woman in the foreground, Patricia Gonzalez, has been the president of the Center for Marine Research now for 6 years. So it's pretty exciting to have been part of that. Now, I know submersibles have been in the news. I can talk about that later. But I want to talk about it now because it's part of the story, even though we're not in Cuba. We're in Alaska in the Bering Sea. I was there with Greenpeace, not chaining myself to anything, but exploring the deep parts of the Bering Sea. Now, you may not know it, but the two largest underwater canyons in the world are in the Bering Sea, including the Zhemchug Canyon. That means pearls in Russian. And the BBC did a little animation that shows just how big this canyon is.
The largest canyon on the planet is the Zhemchug. It's nearly 2 miles deep at its deepest point and 144 miles long and 62 miles wide. Of course, it's normally hidden by the Pacific Ocean, but the Zhemchug is so wide it's impossible to see from one side to the other unless you're above the curvature of the Earth.
So in the morning in the galley, the representative that we were working with, my colleague from Greenpeace, had a coffee mug with little paper slips in it, and I pulled number one. So I became the first human to dive a submersible into Zhemchug Canyon, quite an honor. But it was like a pen light on a huge tapestry. It's humbling. The ocean's so big and vast. Sub could only go to 2,000 feet, and that's 2 miles deep. But this is why we were here, and this is why I'm showing you this. That is coral, deep water corals that we didn't even know could exist until a few decades ago. Wasn't that long ago. And they're all over the world, 2,000 feet down. This is called Swiftia pacifica. And corals can live to be 4,000 years old, witness to the birth of the Bronze Age, the completion of Stonehenge, the reign of the pharaohs of Egypt, the birth of Christ, and the finale of Breaking Bad. That's a long time to be alive. And these corals are beautiful. There's an anemone there. But where you find corals, you find fish. These are important refugia is the correct way to say it. This is bamboo coral, and you see that beautiful halibut hanging out in there. So coral is very, very important, and of course, these days we can't talk about anything without showing an octopus. But you see that red line? That's how deep I was. That's nothing. The Titanic is about this deep, but here, the Mariana Trench is 7 miles deep. And the thing is, we literally know more about the backside of the moon than we do about the bottom of the ocean. We've mapped the backside of the moon. We've barely explored the oceans. And it was in 1960 that the bathyscaphe Trieste, pictured here, with two pilots, went to the bottom of the Mariana Trench. And he looked out the window, one of the pilots, and you know what he saw? As Sylvia Earle would say, two eyes looking right back at him. It was a little flat fish swimming at 7 miles deep. Amazing. Everything we were taught about the lifelessness of the bottom of the ocean proved to be wrong. So we all know the names of the first two astronauts that landed on the moon. Neil Armstrong, number two. Very good. Who knows the names of the first two pilots to go to the bottom of the sea? Not Cousteau. Some kids said me. No, I'm not that old. That's Don Walsh. He was actually on TV earlier today. That's him at the time in the background, Captain Don Walsh, and in the foreground, Jacques Picard, part of the famous Picard family of explorers. And if that name sounds kind of familiar, Gene Roddenberry paid homage to the Picard family with Captain Jean-Luc Picard, now Admiral, captain of the Enterprise D and E. And of course, the mission to seek out new life and new civilizations. Well, guess what? We've got them right here. So much of the ocean has been unexplored. Just came out more than 5,000 new species, 5,000, in a Pacific deep sea mining hotspot. This is a totally different topic, but one of my star students and interns just published this paper in the Global Americans about the dangers of deep sea mining, which we're talking about now. Oh, and does anyone know what this is called? Found thousands of feet below the surface in Spain? I'm going to give you a hint. One love, one love. The Bob Marley worm. See the dreadlocks? And who said scientists didn't have a sense of humor? So here we are back in Cuba. Look again, where you see coral, you see fish. That is elkhorn coral. It is on the US endangered species list. It is thriving in Cuba. All those grunts and goatfish that you see, it's absolutely beautiful. Okay, I think this is the only quiz I have for you tonight. What is coral? Animal, mineral, or vegetable? Animal, mineral, vegetable? It's all three. It's a trick question. Okay, it's an animal because it's got polyps, but it's a colonial animal. They live, you know, thousands of these things in one organism. They have a symbiotic algae that lives within them. It uses photosynthesis to give the corals some sugar. And in return, the algae have a place to hang out. And meanwhile, it's excreting calcium carbonate, so it's a mineral. How cool is that? So you can see the little polyps in this photograph. Again, that's elkhorn coral. So why do we even care about reefs, besides the fact that they're just beautiful? Maybe a quarter of all marine species and a quarter of all fish species depend on coral reefs. Billions of dollars to the world economy. Right now, more than half of new cancer drug research is focused on marine life. and they're also very important to coastal protection. Now, if you took all of the corals in the world and put them together, they would just fill the state of Texas. That's all we have. And that's a precious, precious resource for our planet. And as you can see, corals are not doing so well. This is from the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. It's not a good situation at all for corals. And I'm going to tell you why in a moment. But does anybody remember Eastern Airlines? I'm not the only one? Okay. That is my ticket from 1974 from Philadelphia to Miami. I went to the Florida Keys, and I went to a place called Sea Camp. And it changed my life. And this is what I saw. Elkhorn coral, look how healthy that is. 10 years later, covered with algae. 10 years later, 10 years later, and most recently, 2014, you can barely tell there was a reef there. 80 to 90% of the coral reefs in the Florida Keys are dead. It's heartbreaking. And it makes you want to have a time machine. Well, I didn't have a DeLorean handy, but I found a 53 Buick. That was my time. I don't actually know if it's a Buick or a Chevy, whatever. So anybody knows, tell me. This was my time machine to take me back. That Elkhorn coral that you see looks better than what I remember in the 70s in the Florida Keys. It is healthy, it is full of fish, and it goes on for 30 miles along the southern coast of Cuba as a barrier reef. I couldn't believe my eyes. Again, this species is on the endangered species list. So, again, something very uplifting but also very curious. That coral is sitting in the same hot water that our corals are sitting in. What in the world is going on? Beautiful brain coral, no disease at all. And if you hold up a comparison, 1975, 2015, I think it's a fair comparison. That is pillar coral that's on the cover of the book. But you know, we have a living laboratory. We have a coral reef that's actually working, and that's why 60 Minutes wanted to come down with us. By the way, I had the hair first. I'm older than him. That's why they wanted to come down, because they did a piece on coral reefs. They knew the public wouldn't understand it unless they saw what a healthy coral reef looked like. This is on YouTube. I'll just show you the trailer.
It was Christopher Columbus who named this area the Gardens of the Queen, after his queen, Isabella. But the real gardens, he probably never even got a glimpse of. To see them, you have to go underwater.
This is really the most incredibly well-protected and flourishing reef I've ever seen.
Every time we went diving, we could see sharks circling our boat before we even went in. Our guide said they wouldn't bother us. We certainly hoped he was right.
I was the guy that mentioned, they did ask me not to kill Anderson Cooper, and I'm happy to report I did not. So of course the question is, what's happening in Cuba? Is this an accident of history? Is this strong laws and regulations? You know, mostly what we're hearing in the media about coral reefs has to do with climate change and hot water. And a lot of that is very spot on. This is bleached coral. It's not necessarily dead, but when it gets hot, those symbiotic algae, they take off. So it leaves the corals in a weakened condition. And unfortunately, there were major warming events that bleached the corals and then killed them. And we've lost half of the corals in the Great Barrier Reef off of Australia. That's primarily due to climate change. But that's not the only factor. In fact, there are many factors. I describe corals as the princess and the pea. They pretty much hate everything that we do. So what is killing corals? Well, we've got global factors, climate change, ocean acidification. But look at all these local factors that we actually have control over: nutrient pollution, overfishing, destructive fishing practices, diseases. And I'll explain those in a moment. Now, this is sort of the icon of pollution. And this was a huge problem in the past. We had the Cuyahoga River catch on fire. And Richard Nixon signed monumental environmental legislation, Republican, by the way. He started EPA, he started NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and he signed the Clean Water Act of 1972. And it's worked. Here's the Schuylkill in the 19th century. I wouldn't want to swim in there. And this is 1981, as recently as 81 off Spring Garden Street. Our waters were severely contaminated by toxins. But now, people kayak in the Schuylkill. Clean Water Act worked. In fact, a lot of people kayak in the Schuylkill River. I mean, a real lot of people. And I don't know what these people are doing, but they're in the Schuylkill as well. It's a success story, but the problem is there's another more insidious type of pollution that's taken its place. Okay, another quiz. Number one irrigated crop in the United States. Not soybeans, not corn, not wheat. Anybody? Turf grass, exactly. 40 million acres. And the problem is we have this weird competition with our neighbors to make our lawns clean, green, and we fertilize, and all that fertilizer runs off into our streams, and it does the same thing that it does on your lawn or house plants. It stimulates the growth in the water of algae, and that's what can cover coral reefs. Not so many lawns in Cuba. Of course, there's agriculture, especially industrialized agriculture, the runoff of nutrient pollution, again, fertilizers, and organic material from other sources. But I was talking to kids in Ohio. This is a stream behind their school, and they wanted to help the Gulf when we had the Deepwater Horizon incident. I said, well, literally in your own backyard, tell your parents not to fertilize so much. And if you look at that pink area, 44% of the continental U.S. drains into the Gulf of Mexico, and this is what it looks like. All that algae dies, bacteria go to work on it, it uses oxygen, and so you have a huge area the size of New Jersey that's dead. It's a dead zone. No jokes about New Jersey, they have the best pizza in the world. But if New Jersey were dead, we would do something about it. This is simply hidden from view. I'm still talking about nutrients, but it starts with this collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991. And what it did to Cuba was horrific. Cuba lost all of its support. The most incredible euphemism in the world, the special period. People were starving. They were losing weight, up to 25% of their body weight. There was no transportation. They built contraptions like this that could haul 100 people. It's called a camello. This is the equivalent of Julia Child, Nitza Viapo, in Cuba on TV, teaching people how to cook. She was teaching people how to use banana peels to make ropa vieja, which is shredded beef. None of my friends ever tried that recipe, by the way. And it became a 25-year jail sentence to kill a cow, which people were doing because they were hungry. I think it's still a sentence. This is a current picture. This is still how Cuba is farming. because there were no fertilizers, Cuba was forced to do organic farming. Roughly 70% of agriculture in Cuba is organic. And that has had a positive effect on the environment. I took this picture 10 years ago. It looks ancient. So the theory was that Cuba's rivers and streams were free of nutrient pollution. And just recently, a scientific paper, a colleague of mine at University of Vermont, has demonstrated that's exactly true. Far fewer nutrients than we're dealing with in the rest of the world. And that's not stimulating the growth of algae, which is not smothering the corals. And by the way, if you want the best vegetables in the world, you go to an organoponico, which is all organic. I thought there was something wrong with my camera, how green these lettuce leaves are. Pretty incredible. So I talked about nutrient pollution. I want to talk a little bit about water. Now, I've worked in the Everglades for many years. How many of you have been to the Everglades? Well, actually, if you've been anywhere from Orlando to Key West, you've been in the Everglades. It's one large ecosystem, and all that water flows almost imperceptibly slowly and gets filtered and cleaned across that. And our estuaries, where you have a mix of fresh and salt water, they depend on that delicate balance. These are the nursery grounds for our fish, many of the ones that we like to eat. But we can't resist getting a good steam shovel going, and we carved up the Everglades and replumbed it. It's actually one of the most incredible engineering feats in the world, but it's changed the flow of water dramatically. I just took this out of my airplane window in March. You can kind of see the dividing line. But one thing I said in my testimony to Congress trying to pass the bill to restore the Everglades is we've managed to make fresh water a pollutant. Now, what do I mean by that? And I mean that we've taken that slow water and we've made it fast water. All of a sudden, there are these huge pulses of fresh water running off parking lots and all of that going into those estuaries. And that is lethal to the juvenile fish and other creatures in there. Now, in Cuba, there's the Cuban version of the Everglades. They call it the Cuban Everglades, Cienega de Zapata. And they didn't carve it up. And most of their water is still running slowly. Now, this is not to say Cuba's done everything perfectly. In 1966, Fidel said, "We also plan to develop all our water resources with the goal of not permitting one drop of water to reach the sea." Oh my God. Can imagine the estuaries. It did damage to the estuaries. Fortunately, it did allow some water to make it to the sea and maybe was a benefit to coral reefs, but still not a great idea. So this is a report came out a number of years ago about the fact that we've lost half of the corals in the Caribbean. And that's about true for the entire world. So why does this report have a parrotfish stuck in a net on the cover instead of a coral reef? It's a beautiful fish. You see it's got a beak like a parrot. And this is what parrotfish do. They eat coral. But what they're doing is eating dead coral and all that algae. They're cleaning the reef of algae. Now wait for it. Wait for it. There we go. In case you missed that, here's the replay. So if you're a scuba diver and you're kneeling in the sand around a coral reef, chances are that's passed through the anus of a parrotfish, and you should feel proud about that. But fish are important. They play an important role, and unfortunately, we're eating them. And we've depleted the oceans of fish. And we didn't think that was possible. We thought fish were inexhaustible, the cod fishery. This is how it was done in the 19th century. This is a Russian trawler. This is in the Bering Sea. Nobody could imagine we'd be fishing at this scale. And nobody could imagine the collapse of the cod fishery, the great cod fishery, and it shows no signs of coming back. I told you I was going to depress you a little bit. But we also manage fish like we manage crops. Maximum sustainable yield. This could be the same graph we use for corn. But fish are not crops that grow in the ocean. They're part of the ecosystem. And they've got jobs, as I said, and one of their jobs is to clean the reefs. Now, it's been a double whammy for coral reefs because one of the, if not the largest, underwater pandemics in the world happened in the early 80s. This long-spined sea urchin, which also cleans coral reefs, disappeared, probably because of a virus carried by a ship coming through the Panama Canal. They don't know for sure. So between the loss of them and the loss of the fish and the nutrient pollution, the reefs were slimed and they died. And in addition, coral diseases. And papers now showing that some of these diseases are linked to ships and some linked to human sewage. Now in the Florida Keys, somebody had the bright idea of building septic tanks in limestone, which is very porous. So one of the most expensive parts of the Everglades restoration program is building one of the longest sewer systems in the world along the Florida Keys to prevent all those nutrients from getting out and sliming the reefs. Okay, somebody mentioned his name earlier, Jacques Cousteau.
Fiery Dawn finds a complex new mission beginning. As the rediscovery of the world lures Calypso to Cuba, the Caribbean's most intriguing island.
I wish I could show you the whole thing. But one of the key parts of this that came out was he said, this is 1985, the reef more rich than any I have seen in years. So even in 1985, this had already started taking its toll on coral reefs. Interestingly, he and Fidel became good friends. And in fact, there's a famous story at the Rio summit in 1992 that they're posing for a photo of the heads of state. Fidel sees Cousteau walking by, grabs him and says, you need to be in this photograph. So Cousteau, as the leader of the oceans, is part of the of that photograph. But all of my Cuban colleagues told me Fidel was hugely influenced by Cousteau and became a conservationist after that. And I always tried to, you know, document that somewhere. And it wasn't until I brought Bobby Kennedy to Cuba a number of years ago. We won't go into the politics right now. He met with Fidel, and we were on our boat, and a strange boat approached us. They delivered a letter from Fidel to Bobby, and in it, it said, Jacques Cousteau was a huge influence on me, and I realized the importance of conservation. And that was confirmation. And Cuba adopted some of the most leading environmental laws in the world, a basic right of society and its citizens, the environment, a healthy environment, a network of protected areas, world-class, 25% of their waters in marine protected areas, basically like underwater national parks. And this just recently, one of 10 countries to put climate change into its constitution. Can you imagine that discussion here? F- For years, that's an interesting alarm. Quiet down. Okay. For years, we treated the environment as something we had for free. We dumped as much as we could into it, and we took as much as we could for it. But we never put a value on it. And a study done, for example, by the World Resources Institute in Belize shows that the value of coral reefs for shoreline protection is greater than the value of coral reefs for tourism and fisheries combined. Environmental economics is helping us really understand the value of coral reefs. And unfortunately, economics is the playing field we're in. Coral reefs can reduce 97% of wave energy. And when you consider building seawalls and gray infrastructure, it's no comparison. 15 times less expensive to restore coral reefs than it is to build seawalls and the like. So we've been working with the Cubans on a number of workshops in Cuba, in the United States, on environmental economics, because they're required by law to use environmental economics in decision making, something very unusual for a socialist country. There's a study in Palau that says that a shark that might be worth, I don't know, $1,000 on your dinner plates is worth $2 million over its lifetime for tourism. This is getting at some of the heart of all of this in terms of the value of the environment to us in economic terms. We did a report on tourism. It's a two-edged sword. It does bring in money. It's very valuable. But it's also one of the biggest causes of loss of mangroves in the Caribbean. Now, Cuba is no stranger to tourism. In fact, that's my grandmother in 1930 on her honeymoon in Havana. But mass tourism has taken hold. In fact, I was doing a presentation and I cannot, for the life of me, come up with the Spanish version of spring break. But this has been a failed model. It has really wreaked havoc on the environment and the societies around the world. Now, in Gardens of the Queen, this is the largest no-take marine reserve in the Caribbean, and I thought that their enforcement boat would look like this. This is what it actually looks like. And it's because of economics, because people like Elsa, she's a housekeeper, or you know, a chambermaid, you know, on a liveaboard dive boat. She makes a lot of money, as do the rest of the people. She's the enforcement. She knows every boat that belongs in that area, and if she sees a boat that doesn't belong there, you know she's going to take action. And so we've been working in the Isle of Youth, which is actually the seventh largest island in the Caribbean, but it's kind of hidden there. Nobody knows about it. And it's gorgeous. And it's gorgeous. And a little kid learning to drive. But Cuba has opportunities to not follow the leader in terms of mass tourism. You know, we are all willing to pay a premium for an authentic experience away from all the crowds. There's an opportunity for small-scale tourism and provide incentive to people to protect their environment because they know that's what people want to see. This is the first bed and breakfast in Cocodrilo in the southern part. It's also a dive center, which means when you sleep, there are regulators from the 1980s dangling above your head. I told them they needed some mosquito netting. But here's maybe the most important slide as I start to wrap up, is that those local factors, overfishing, nutrient pollution, we can control that. It's that old think global, act local. And addressing local threats can build resilience to global threats. That's true of coral reefs. That's the theory why coral reefs in Cuba are as healthy as they are, because local factors are probably as important, if not more important, than climate change to many of these reefs. So On the positive side, we're establishing huge protected areas, which means no fishing. Papahanaumokuakea in Hawaii was established by George W. Bush, a Republican, and doubled in size by Barack Obama, a Democrat. How about that? And it's no take. You do not take anything out of that area. You leave the ecosystem intact. There's encouraging news from NOAA that we're better managing our fish populations, and that includes in places like the Keys. So here, those parrotfish are going to come back and graze. In terms of nutrient pollution, Chesapeake Bay, we have commissions set up to try to get a handle on all those nutrients that are coming into Chesapeake Bay. And we can do something in our own backyards. Once again, we can kill our lawns. I almost did that when I was in Florida. Replant with native vegetation. This is part of the Florida Yards and Neighborhoods program. Now, in terms of coral reefs, we're just buying time. They can't be resilient indefinitely. They predict we're going to lose 70 to 90% of our corals by the end of the century. But, you know, we are in a triage situation. We can't save everything. But the latest science, ignore the colors, this is a confusing diagram, but they found 50 areas around the world that had the best chance of surviving and repopulating areas downstream. And if we focus on the Caribbean, of those 50, five of those areas, 10%, are in Cuban waters. And that's another reason we really want to work in Cuba and make sure to protect those areas. There's also selective breeding, genetic modification to try to get these corals more tolerant to climate change and replant those thermally tolerant corals. So there's a lot of good that's going on right now. You know, I like to say for years we succeeded where diplomats failed. It's really brought us together. And when Air Force One landed in Cuba, we did get a shout out. Our governments will work together to protect the beautiful waters of the region that we share. So there's now government to government work going on this. Well, I want to close by talking about why I'm also, the last reason why I'm optimistic. I've been traveling to all 50 states talking to kids, students about the oceans. And I'm a little over halfway, finally. And these kids are ready. They are excited about the oceans. That was Alaska, this is the Virgin Islands, Kansas. They're ready to take their spot at the wheel. This is Atlanta. They're bright-eyed and they care. This is even in Cuba, we did some joint education programs. And these are my students at Johns Hopkins, who I call the new ocean doctors. They're excited, they want to help, and I think they can give us hope. Thank you very much.
Is there any program or effort for synthetic coral or growing it, you know, like the fish on land, and they can be grown on land and then transferred out to the ocean?
That's what they are doing at University of Miami right now, and that's really a selective breeding effort where they're growing them in tanks and finding out which of those corals are most likely to survive, and they're doing exactly that, replanting them.
David, you mentioned that Foster was very instrumental in helping out with the environmental as it related to coral. What has happened with the presidents that have come in after him? Have they automatically gone along with the thought that Fidel had, as you see it?
Yeah, they are continuing a strong set of environmental laws. I haven't seen anything backing off of those laws. The problem is right now after COVID and basically the destruction of the Cuban economy, it's still awful down there. They're desperate for dollars. And one way to get them is through tourism. So there's a great fear right now that they are gonna go that mass tourism route. And there's a lot of fights going on right now to try to convince them that that's a mistake that would cheapen the experience and moving into small scale tourism at a higher price is really the way to go. So that's the main thing I'm personally very concerned about.
So these large scale cruise ships that they have a particular focus on that area of the ocean or that area of the world that has a lot of the coral and stuff. And what is their impact? Are they developing their fuel source? What are they doing? What are they made to do?
Yeah, that's a long topic. I'm going to be really quick, and I can fill you in later on some of the details. But one of them is just the impact to these small communities, dumping 5,000 people in to buy T-shirts and all of the rest. It transforms communities into something different. Bilge water. And dumping bilge water that they call gray water, that's been a problem because that's nutrient pollution. You know, it's basically primarily treated sewage from these ships, and there are regulations for them now to dump that further offshore. Another issue is you've got all these people, and you don't want to throw them all onto a coral reef at once. And then the question becomes, do you spread them out? Or do you sacrifice a particular area for the tourists? And some of the cruise ships have their own islands, and that's kind of where they've concentrated people. The other thing, finally, is just economics. If you have a non-cruise ship tourist, you will make 13 times more money than you will from a cruise ship passenger. And that's, you know, you think of it as an all-inclusive. You're not going to eat in town when you can eat for free on the ship, you know, or drink for free or whatever. You know, it's a difficult, and you don't need lodging. So those are a few of the issues that are of concern. I'm not saying they're all bad, but they do have an impact and need to be, you know, managed.
I was in Italy last year. Italy has this agriturismo program. Their farms, and the farms have lodging. They cook the food from the farm, and they get visitors. Our tour group could have been 25 people, but it was only 9. But it was a very local experience, and I wondered if anything like that is being pursued or could be pursued in places like Cuba, which would bring revenue but not spoil the environment.
When I take groups to Cuba, it's one of their favorite activities. So you saw that organoponico, that farm with the bright green lettuce? So nearby is a restaurant that they supply with food. They teach the visitors first how to make a mojito, of course, and then put them to work in the kitchen with flames and knives all over the place and cooking up that food. They teach them how to do it, and they love it, and the food's delicious, and it's fresh. And so I think it's a great model because you learn, and it's an activity, hands-on activity, and you eat, and it's great.
Is to the cause of pandemic and how it has affected the endeavor to help protect the wildlife and the corals. How has the pandemic affected it? And if we are to get into another pandemic, what are safeguards do you think that could help from any issues that arose from that?
Are you talking about the underwater pandemic?
Yes.
Yeah. Unfortunately, nobody froze one of those diadema, the sea urchins. They were all put in formaldehyde, so that killed, you know, denatured all of the whatever, you know, virus, which is also still just a theory, was responsible. So, but the best guess is that it was a virus and that it did come from the bilge of a ship coming through the Panama Canal. They take on water after they unload to you know, get lower and more seaworthy in the water, and they do the opposite when they take on a load. The pandemic started in Panama, right at the mouth of the Panama Canal in the Caribbean, and spread within days across. It spread so incredibly fast. It wiped out 90-something percent of the population. They still haven't recovered. Maybe 10%, 15%. Cuba's doing better than any other place. But I think a lot of this points to the dangers of what the Panama Canal represents. These viruses and other pathogens can remain viable in the bilge of these ships for a long time, and there's still talk about a sea level canal, you know, and widening the canal and all of these other things to speed the passage of ships through the canal. And I think this just highlights the dangers. So if anybody asks you if you want a sea level canal, please say no.
Thank you, David, for this amazing and inspirational presentation and work. Are you aware, the question is, are you aware of any important partnership between the U.S. and Cuba in order to preserve the coral reefs? I'm aware of the Environmental Defense Fund doing work there, mm-hmm. but besides them, is there any other major organization?
Well, there are a number of NGOs working together on that, including my organization, of course, Environmental Defense Fund and others, World, I always get their name wrong. But I, along with several other people, in 2011, created the Trinational Initiative, which brings together Cuba, the U.S., and Mexico to work on marine issues, including coral reefs, but also including things like sea turtles and manatees and other specialties. And the Trinational Initiative is a non-governmental body that works mostly among scientists. But once things opened up, we did get governmental participation in that. And we're getting more and more government-to-government work. Now, the Trump administration really chilled that. And then COVID came along. So those relationships, government-to-government, are pretty weak right now. But we'll see. You know, we have to be optimistic. But again, my surprise, after 60 minutes, 19 million people saw that. Hundreds of emails that were positive, no hate mail. Well, one really weird email, but we won't go into that. And after the book, I knew it was you. And after the book came out, also biting my nails. You know, the Miami Cuban community, of course, is, you know, very strong, but the environment has survived this political tension. I think both sides understand that this is apolitical. Actually, it's not. Nothing can be apolitical when you have the U.S. and Cuba working together. But, you know, Cuban Americans want their homeland to be beautiful. They want it to stay healthy. They care. They understand this is about science and conservation. So I feel lucky that we've been able to, you know, do this all these years, and it's considered one of the best examples of U.S.-Cuba collaboration. And, you know, we've just put our heads down and gotten a lot of work done. I've gotten myself into plenty of trouble, don't worry. But, you know, you can read about that in the book.
I was wondering if in your research, if you were somehow able to quantify or maybe estimate the amount of coral bleaching due to climate change versus some of the more local and maybe more controllable factors that you talk about, or is it more like one influences the other?
It's a great question, and I actually would tell you without my data next to me, but my own observations informally are that most bleaching is caused by warming. And we see bleaching in Cuba. Even deep down, I was 30 feet down and the water temperature was almost 90 degrees, really hot water. And there's bleaching going on, but by November, when it cools down, that coral has its algae back, it's back. I think the point is that all of these other factors keep the ecosystem healthy, what we do locally, and the corals become more resilient and have a better chance of surviving. And I also want to make the point that that's not just limited to corals. There's studies in California, there's studies in Delaware Bay, looking at the importance of doing things right locally that actually can make the wildlife, the corals, or whatever is important in a particular region more resilient to climate change. And that's really what gives me a great deal of hope for coral reefs and everything else. It's something that we can control and something that we should feel inspired about and should go out and do. So anyway, great question. Maybe I'll get researching that one a little bit more. Thank you, everybody, and I'll see you upstairs.